I'm your MC for the evening, and we hope to put on a pretty good little show for you. Some weather we're having, isn't it? Beautiful. About time it changed, right? You know, I was talking to my neighbor Ed the other day. Well, he used to be married to Ethel, but anyway, that's a long story. But Ed says that his summer weather reminds him of Ethel. And I said, well, how is that, Ed? He says, well, when the summer was good, we'd all go to the state fair. I said, well, that sounds like fun. He says, yeah. And every year I'd go with Ethel, and there was a helicopter ride for $50. And every single year Ethel would say what? Nope, 50 bucks is 50 bucks. We ain't riding that helicopter. This goes on for 10 years. Finally, Ed's turning 70, right? And he says, I'm turning 70, Ethel. Isn't it time for me to ride the helicopter? Ethel says, nope, 50 bucks is 50 bucks. Well, that helicopter pilot standing over there near the helicopter, all proud, been there for the last 10 years listening to all this, he decides he's going to let him ride. He says, oh, you know what? I'm going to let Ed and your wife Ethel ride in that helicopter, and I'm not going to charge you a thing. He says, I'm going to do all kinds of things, but if you don't make one sound, one peep, one noise, the helicopter rides on me. Well, Ethel looks at Ed and says, get in the chopper, Ed. So they hop in the chopper, and that helicopter pilot, he takes that thing up, and he's good. And he takes it all the way over to the right, and he takes it all the way to the left. He does half a flip, and he starts setting that helicopter down. He looks in the back seat and says, say, Ed, I can't believe you didn't say anything. And Ed says, well, I was going to say something after the first turn when Ethel flew out, but 50 bucks is 50 bucks. Well, we've heard Guthrie Matthews tonight, and he did a wonderful job, and we're going to hear a lot more from him. We're also going to hear from a lot of other authors that are in the audience tonight. I'd like to let you know who they may be. Brent Lewis, who you may or may not be familiar with. Anyway, Brent Lewis is with us tonight. We also have Harold O. Wilson. Fantastic. Yes, let's give him a round of applause. Rebecca Colburn, Marshall Hanlon, and all these folks are out here as well presenting their product, presenting their wares in the foyer, so make sure you go out there and visit and see what they've got. I think it's a wonderful job being able to write like that. I can't. I barely got out of seventh grade. I just had to plagiarize. Oh, sorry, Brent. Anyway, Brent is my producer, so there's a lot of give and take. So in the spirit of things, I'd like to also thank Rick and Val Colby, who are our hosts this evening. They did not charge us one dime for this room, so leave it as you found it. They're back there preparing some of your meals, obviously, but that's fantastic they were able to lend us this room. Our spotlight authors of the evening are going to be Kenton Kilgore, songwriter Guthrie Matthews, and Peggy Jaegly. And we're going to have an opportunity to hear some of the readings. We've heard some of his music. We're going to hear more of his music, and we're going to hear some of the readings from these folks. We're also going to mention a few other authors that have some things out there and a little bit about them. And then we're going to have a chance to interview them and find out what kind of makes them tick, how do they think like this. There could be some dark caverns, I don't know. But I think it's going to be an enjoyable evening. So why don't you give us another one, Guthrie?
Sure. Dark caverns, huh? I am a little on my own desire.
watch you sip and sip and fago. Fago. Sip and sip and fago. Destruction like a moth in flames. I want to end it on a series of stupid games. The physical at first, and the day by day, it all comes to an end, and this is all I have to say. I have to say that I won't lie on. Sit back and watch me sing my song on fire.
Well, I would be remiss if I didn't mention the fact that we are recording live for Queen Anne's County Television, Channel 7 on your cable guide. They are here with us this evening with both cameras, so don't say anything off color. It'll be recorded. So, our first guest today will be Peggy Jaegly. She grew up in a house full of books. She's read these books, bringing them to life, pretending she was one of the characters. She started writing as a young child, sending thank you notes with rhyming poetry and creating short stories to entertain her family. She is an author who writes both fiction and nonfiction, has been the editor of both a city and national magazine, and as an instructor of the craft of writing to help others fulfill their dream of writing their own books. Today, her home is filled with shelves of books, many of which are hers. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Peggy Jaegly. A couple of Peggy's most recent. Very nice.
Thank you all for coming. Tonight, the theme is storytelling. So in that spirit, I dug through my files because I have been a writer since a child. So the first story I'm going to read, I wrote at age 8. I wrote short stories to explain things that I wondered about. And what I was impressed with at age 8 is children are so honest. And this story has some real emotions in it. And it's something as I wrote, I kind of forgot and had to relearn. But a child knows that not everything in the world is perfect. So this story is how the elephant got its trunk. One day, a baby elephant was born to Mr. and Mrs. May. It was their 10th child. Now, he was quite different from the rest of the family. He had a long, dangly thing on his face. He was very ashamed, for it looked like he had two tails. His parents were worried and called Dr. Morgan a wise old owl. He examined him very carefully. After he was through, he told the family that he had a disease and that anyone who caught the disease would get a thing called a trunk. And you keep sneezing until you get a trunk as long as 6 feet. So then Dr. Morgan, Mr. and Mrs. May started to warn the others. All the animals tried to stay away from him and the disease, but all failed and all the elephants caught it. But later they were glad because one day Mr. May saw thousands of their worst enemies coming, the mice. Mr. May raised his trunk and gave the biggest, noisiest warning. And one thing when I read these stories was the notes I made to myself, because my mother always taught me not to lie. So I felt compelled to sign it and then add the footnote, the story is made up. One of the things when I write, and I just naturally do it, is I embed my stories with a spiritual lesson, whether it's a mystery, books for business women, or short stories. There's always a spiritual lesson that works its way in. It doesn't take away from the story, but if you're a spiritual person, you'll get the lesson. And you know, if you're not oriented that way, you'll just get a good story. So this is a story I wrote at age 13, and I was kind of surprised that I had put a spiritual lesson in this even at that young age. And this is a story about a farm girl attending a dance with her friends and a gypsy who owned an unbroken earring that she was willing to sell at a price. It was a tiny earring. It was made of glass and silver, shaped like an elf shoe. Hanging in Susie's ear, it gave a tinkle each time she moved her head, as if a miniature bell were ringing. "But there's only one, Auntie," she said. Aunt Janet peered over her steel-rimmed glasses. "The other earring is still owned by the gypsy. She said that two would jangle your partner's mind, but one would make his heart dance in time with yours." At the prom, beside a sea of teenage dancers, Susie wasn't so sure of Gypsy's prophecy. Her friends were swirling in the arms of their boyfriends, but she, Susie Holden of Butternut Farm, lived too far away for dancing school, so she had never learned the intricate steps of the teeter-tot, the newest craze. Her feet felt like wooden clubs. She edged toward the chaperone's corner. "Susie?" Ed Martin glided her onto the floor. His chin touched her forehead. His arms led her expertly in the teeter-top patterns. Ed Martin, with his golden hair and gentle voice, president of her class. "What's that chime, that little tingling?" he whispered. She shook her curls happily. She was dancing like starlight on water, dipping and twinkling, as if she had known the teeter-top forever. Suddenly, the earring flew off. It dropped under Ed's feet. Crunch. "Ouch," said Susie as she stepped on his foot. "I'm terribly sorry," apologized Ed. "I stepped on something and it got me out of step. Hey, is this your earring?" "Well, it was." "Look, it's getting crowded. Why don't we go out onto the patio?" "Okay." When they finally reached the patio, Susie felt listless. Ed turned towards her. "Susie, are you sore at me for wrecking your earring?" "Why, no, it's just that..." "That what?" "Oh, nothing. Come on, I want to know. If I tell you, you're going to say it's absolutely ridiculous." "No, I won't, I promise." "Well, the earring is one that my aunt gave me. She got it from a gypsy. The gypsy will only sell the other earring at some special price. Anyway, the magical legend behind the earring is that when it tinkles, your true love is supposed to come to you." Here, Ed broke out in a lustrous laugh. "Why, Ed Martin, I don't think it's funny." "Oh, Susie, I'm not laughing at you. I'm laughing at myself. You think that none of the boys really like you, at least the ones you like. But do you realize I had to flip a coin to get this dance with you? If you really wanted to dance with me, why didn't you ask to bring me to this prom?" I try to, but you were always with one of your girlfriends, and I always had the misfortune to see you boarding the bus. I think I've learned a valuable lesson tonight. What is it? That a person doesn't need magic to make his or her dream come true, but just to be himself and do his best. In a way, I think that might be the price of the other earring. You know what, I'd ask? What? You're right, because my mother is the so-called gypsy, just in case I needed an excuse to talk with you. Laughing over their foolishness, they joined the party again, ready for an evening of fun. And this story was in a booklet of short stories that I wrote for my parents' 23rd wedding anniversary. And I had to laugh when I read the last page of the book, because this is what it said. Due to the fact that my imagination is on strike on the grounds of fatigue, more stories will be added soon, but at a later date. Happy anniversary. So I guess even at 13, I experienced writer's block. Thank you.
That's fantastic. Come on over and sit down.
Well, you started writing at a very young age. How young were you when you wrote your first little story?
I was very young. My mother always made my siblings and I write thank you notes for any gifts that we got.
Right.
And so not only did I write thank you notes, I wrote poetry thank you notes.
Okay, so you write poetry.
Mm-hmm.
You write children's stories.
Mm-hmm.
You write nonfiction. What type do you...
I'm a harpist, so I wrote training for therapeutic harpists, how
okay.
to start a business, and for just women in general, how to run a business.
So you started playing the harp then, obviously very young. I understand that's a rather difficult instrument to play, isn't it?
I took it up as an adult, actually.
Did you really?
Yes.
No kidding. And you live here locally?
Yes. Right here in Centerville.
Oh, well, so it was a short commute for you for this evening. That's good.
Yes.
We don't have to pay a gas fee, so that's great. So you have the hobbies of harp.
Yes.
I understand in your bio you also have been an editor for city and national magazines. Which ones?
Well, it was when I lived in Toledo, Ohio.
Oh, okay.
A publisher started a magazine called Toledo Alive.
Okay.
So that was my first editorship, even though I contributed to many local magazines.
Right.
And then I worked for a while for Women's World.
Oh, all right. So what are you doing with your time now? You obviously have extra time.
Oh, I wish. I write in my head, I write on my lunch, and most of my day is spent in social services at Corsica Hills Nursing Home.
Okay.
Very fast-paced job.
Yes, I imagine it is. Now, you write in your head, you're right there. Every author has a spot, or it appears to me, that every author has a spot that they like to go and write in. There's a certain comfort factor. It could be a lot of different areas. Where is your spot that you actually physically write?
My favorite spot is my deck in the backyard with a tree that shades me and kind of protects me from the view of the street, but I can see the street, but I'm kind of hidden.
So we're assuming you only write in the summer then?
Oh no, I write all the time.
Well, the winter is cold on that deck, isn't it? Well, that's good. That's great. So you also teach people to write.
Yes.
And where do you do this at? Is it a class or do you teach at a school?
I've been, for over 2 years, been running the Creative Fiction Writers group that meets twice a month at the the Centerville Library.
Oh, okay.
And also online.
Okay.
And, you know, private coaching clients. Because
right.
I think it's really important for people to tell their story.
Your house is full of books.
Yes.
Many of you have written.
Yes.
How many have you written?
I'm losing track, but I'm probably up to like 19 or 20 of books I've written or their anthologies that I'm in.
Okay, so you're always working, you're always writing.
Yes.
It's a release for you.
Yes.
Okay. All right. You're working on anything for the future currently? You have any current, obviously with writing that many books, you're always working on something. Is there something we could see here in the near future?
The next Sweet Pony series
okay.
is coming out. Sweetheart Stops the Bullies. The illustrations are done. It's at the publisher, so in a few months. I'm working on a cozy mystery and a police procedural.
Okay.
And also, I have two booklets out to help aspiring writers, and
okay.
one I'm going to expand longer and make it an ebook.
Well, any of these horses become police ponies because your mind is working on two different projects at the time?
No, he's too sweet.
Oh, is he? Okay.
And all right. He's real.
Yep. Oh, this is a real, is one of your horses?
Yes, he's a Chincoteague pony.
Okay.
And great. I adopted him because he was the pony everyone wanted, and I won him at auction because he was a black pony with a white heart on the shoulder.
Mm.
On his other shoulder is a white angel wing, and on his rump a perfect Celtic heart. So I felt God made him for me.
Now you keep him in town, of course, right?
He's not far from here.
Okay, well, very good. Well, we look forward to seeing more of your publications. Obviously, you're working on two or three, so we're not gonna have to wait very long.
No.
So I appreciate you coming tonight. It's been a pleasure meeting you, and thank you for your reading.
Okay, thank you so much.
Peggy Jaegly, everyone. Let's fall over. Well, how about a little bit more of this fella? How about some more Guthrie? Woo!
That is a song about a dog I had a long time ago. I used to live on a farm in Churchill, Maryland. One day I was sitting on the porch and he was there, just hanging out with me. And he was such a nice dog. He was kind of dumb and didn't really like, you know, he'd be running through the farm and then he'd be like, come here, his name was Dempsey. Come here, Dempsey. That's not the boxer, that's the catcher for the Orioles. And he would run the opposite way if you called him. So, anyway, he inspired me to write this song. Lord,
about a dog. Well, it was wonderful. For those of you viewing and maybe at home on Queen Anne's County Television, Channel 7, which you're a part of tonight, is the third Thursday at the Creamery in Centerville. We have a wonderful guest with us tonight. We have Kenton Kilgore, Guthrie Matthews, and Peggy Jaegly. We also have some other mentions in the audience tonight. One is Rebecca Colburn. She has a book out there for sale, which she just published. And a very interesting young man named Marshall Hanlon. So while going to college, he's able to find time to write a book. He could use the college money, I gotta believe. But take a look at these merchandise out at the merch table. See if there's a book maybe you want to take home with you and help support these authors. And for those of you who may be watching at home, they're also available on iTunes and Amazon. So, all right, I'd like to get to it. I'd like to get to our next guest. And our next guest is, of course, the infamous Kenton Kilgore. He's an author. He's written a number of books. When he's not pretending to do his day job, Kenton Kilgore is forging a new direction in young adult science fiction and fantasy. Kenton and his family live on Kent Island with too many dogs and cats, and he's a horrible taste in music, football teams, and beer. We got to find out more about that. Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, Kenton Kilgore.
Favorite musicians who is not more part of the horrible taste I have in music. But anyway, going on from there, I was an only child, and very early on as a teenager, I met the girl who was going to become my wife, and they sort of adopted me into her very large family. And so I met my future father-in-law, this fellow named Fred. And Fred was a storyteller himself. He would tell all kinds of stories, especially about when he was in the service in the early 60s. He was an Air Force medic, and sometimes he's been gone a few years now. He passed away in 2004. But every so often, my wife and her siblings and I will get together and we'll swap Fred stories. And to tell a Fred story, you have to use the Fred voice, because he had this very distinctive way of talking. And my favorite story about Fred is the time that he was stationed in Okinawa, and he got to know an Okinawan fisherman and his family. And Fred would like, you know, hang out with the locals, and he learned a lot of Japanese and got to know a lot of people. And so he says, the story goes, so one night, the fellow invites me over to dinner. And I swear, this is just how he talked, okay? Fred, not the Okinawan fisherman. So I come to dinner, and of course, because this is a proper Okinawan family, I am the honored guest. So I'm seated there at the head of the table, and the father was there, and his wife, and they had about five daughters of various ages. And the little one came out and brought this soup in front of me and put it in front of me. And before we started eating, the father sort of looked over at my bowl, kind of sighed, looked over at his wife. She looked over at the bowl, kind of sighed. This is Okinawan Japanese culture. Nothing is ever said. Everything is always implied. So the wife looked over at the oldest daughter, kind of sighed. The oldest daughter looked at the daughter under her, and so this went all the way down till the youngest one realized what was happening, took my bowl, ran off to the kitchen, came back with it and put it in front of me, and there was a fish eyeball in my soup. And so I thought to myself, well, now what do I do? Because, of course, I had to eat the fish eyeball. Because as the honored guest, it was a delicacy that was mine to enjoy. And if I didn't eat it, it would be a great dishonor to the family. So I took my chopsticks I plucked the eyeball out of the soup, popped it in my mouth, and swallowed it whole. To which all the little girls were like, the father sort of looked sternly at them for a moment till they stopped. And so I explained in Japanese, well, in America, this is how we eat our fish eyeball soup. Of course. And that satisfied the father, who then explained to me that here in Okinawa, one was supposed to savor it and chew it slowly. But we got through dinner just fine. What I like about being a writer is, you know, like you all, you know, you meet various people in your lives and they'll tell you stories like that. But being a writer means that you can actually like take some of those stories and put them in yours, and then those stories live on forever, and then other people find out about them. Now, some of the stories that Fred told about the service weren't nearly as nice. He was in Vietnam in the early 60s. He was a combat medic. And he used to tell this one story, which is short, but I incorporated it into my book, Lost Dogs. In the book, Lost Dogs, I have a character who is also a Vietnam combat medic. I didn't pattern him specifically after Fred, but I had to have that combat medic in there for the story, and also because I wanted to share this thing that Fred shared with us. And the character in the book, his name is Roy, and the short passage, it goes like this. This fellow Roy, he's an old guy, and he's talking to this dog he's adopted. The dog is sitting there with him, and the dog's having a bad dream, as dogs sometimes do. So Roy wakes up the dog and he says, Roy leans back in his chair. You were shaking and whimpering. Bad dream? I'm with you. Get plenty of those, most of them from a long time ago. Guys in my unit dying in my lap, thinking that just because I was the medic, they'd be all right. Me telling them they'd be okay, they were going out on the next chopper. Sometimes there was no next chopper. I knew that. They didn't. All right, so that's kind of a downer. Yeah. So let's
kind of a downer.
Yes, let's lighten up the mood. So in addition to Fred, another veteran I knew was a veteran of World War II, my Uncle Bill, and he grew up in Boston in the 1930s, 1920s, 1930s, and there's a story he told when he was a kid, and you know, he swears this is true, and so I also incorporated into Lost Dogs, and this is another character tells this story. And I changed things around. The character is an elderly lady, and she's a native of Ken Island. But so the details have changed, but the story is basically the same. And so this character says, I've always had dogs, always loved them. My first one, he was a Newfie. Londo, that was his name. My daddy got him for me when I was little. Couldn't have been more than two. That was before they built the bridge, back when they had the ferry. My folks had a farm down there off Coxnet. Now it's mostly houses and churches. One summer, my brother Jimmy and me and my sissy Lizzybeth and Londo went out wading in Cox Creek, dip netting for crabs, you know. It was even hotter then than it's been lately. Two fellows are out there on their fancy powerboat, chicken neckers. From Annapolis, of course, with more money than sense. They've been drinking and fishing, and they got a little boy with them, and they ain't paying him no mind. That little boy, he sees Londo, and he's at the back of the boat, and he waves and climbs up onto the sides of it like he's going to get a better look. He falls right smack in that water, head first. And those men yell, holy this, and F that, and all other sorts of things they ought not to be saying around kids. And they're trying to turn the boat around, but they're drunker than cats. That little boy, he can't swim. None of them can. I don't know what they was thinking getting on a boat, and none of them know how to even dog paddle. Obviously, they wasn't thinking very much. So Jimmy starts running out further into the creek, but it gets deep fast there, and he's hollering, and he tells Lizzybeth to go get Daddy, but Londo, he just swims out there, and the boy holds on to his tail. Londo, He pulls him back to where we were. He saves that little boy. And by the time those two drunks, turned out they was lawyers, if you can believe that, by the time they drive their boat over to us, our daddy and mama are there, and daddy cusses them up one side and down the other. And Londo just stands there, soaking wet, listening and wondering what all the fuss is. Yes, he does. I'll tell the world.
Very good. You gonna join us?
Yeah, sure.
All right.
There we go.
Well done. Thank you very much, Kenton. Pretending to do a day job.
Pretending to do a day job.
What in the world is the day job?
I'm a criminal.
Okay.
I work for the federal government, so thank you for all the tax
camera.
Money.
Like, oh, you're on camera.
Oh, yeah, all right. Yeah. Okay. It's okay.
It's all right. It's they're aware. Fine.
Yeah. They, yeah. All right. So no, I work for the Office of Railroad Safety in Washington D.C. And seriously, if I can have a 30-second public service announcement.
Go ahead. It's your time.
Our biggest worry, the thing that keeps us up at night, and the thing that the way most people get killed on railroads is by walking around on railroad tracks when they ought not to. So whenever I do these things, I beg people, please, just stay off railroad tracks, because trains are faster than you think, they're more quiet than you think, and it's just awful to see what they do to people. So, you know, tell your kids, tell your friends, don't go walking around on railroad tracks. Okay, we're done.
All right, well, then thank you very much for coming. No, sit down. You live on Kent Island?
Yes.
All right.
I live in Bay City.
Okay.
On Kent Island. We've been there since 98.
By your readings, I can understand your family's very important to you.
Yes.
You have family of your own?
Yes. My wife is here, and we have two daughters.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually started writing. I started publishing books for my daughters when they were little. I started writing.
So they motivated you to start writing.
Right. Well, I was writing all the time. I started as a kid, but what really sort of kicked it in the gear and got me to publish books was my daughters, because I wanted to, you know, write for them. And so that's why I write young adult fantasy and science fiction, because that's what the sort of thing they like.
Okay. So they're your toughest critic then, obviously.
Yeah, and they've totally like gone and aged themselves out of my market. Which
So either you bring your A game up,
right,
or you keep going where you're at, right?
So, yeah.
Well, it's been successful for you, and I'm proud of you for it. Too many dogs and too many cats.
Too many dogs. We have three dogs and three cats. At one point, we had four dogs and three cats. We lost one recently.
Mm-hmm.
And coincidentally, just by coincidence, the latest dog we've adopted, much to my wife's considerable chagrin, is a half lab, half Newfoundland mastodon.
So it's a little dog.
Yeah. He's down. We have him on a diet. He's down to 142 pounds.
Jeez.
And listen, I love dogs. I've had dogs like my whole life. I've had dozens of dogs. This is the dumbest dog I've ever had.
Don't say that. He'll hear you.
He doesn't even know. He's very sweet, and I do love him, but oh my goodness, he is.
Keep your hands full with that one, huh?
Yeah.
So, okay, let's get to it.
Okay.
Music, what's your horrible taste?
I'm a big Kiss fan.
You paint up for Halloween or during the week?
Oh, every Friday night.
Okay.
And like I said, a big Prince fan, but that's actually good music.
Well, that is good music. It's unfortunate to hear his passing today. 57 years old.
Okay.
They're not sure, at the time we came on, we're not sure what he passed away from.
Right.
But he died in his home in, I think it was Minnesota, is that right?
Minneapolis, yeah.
Okay. So we lost one, but from the funeral pyres come another, perhaps, right? So football teams, what's your team?
I'm a Pittsburgh Steelers fan.
Whoa, there's a few of you in there.
It gets worse.
Okay.
My second favorite team is the Redskins.
Well, that one is not so bad. Now, fortunately, we do have security to walk you to your car. Okay. All right.
Told you.
Taste in beer.
Oh, all the beer they serve here, much too good for me. Like, much too good for me. I like really cheap, nasty beer, like Iron City and Natty Bow, and just stuff like that. So, I'm afraid they don't stock that here. They only sell good beer.
You
so I won't be having any.
You mentioned you started writing very young.
Yeah.
How old were you when you started
writing? I was in fourth grade.
Okay.
Fourth grade, I had a teacher, and every Friday, we would either have to write a journal about what happened to us the week before.
Oh, the journals. Well, don't let me bore you.
Or we could write, the next Friday, we'd write like a short story, so.
That was easier.
I took off, oh yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. Took off running with that, and I never stopped.
Did you, any of those short stories when you were very young, like Peggy, for example, did you end up taking them to another level?
No, because mine were terrible. Unlike Peggy. Peggy's were good.
Okay.
I had to work to get, to where I am. This is, yeah.
All right. Okay. And so what moment in time you're writing these short stories, you started out very young, you got going on, and you go, man, you know what? I'm going to try to really do this. What was it? What was the moment? What was the...
It was about more than 10 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said, my daughters were much younger then. And I wanted to write a fairy tale for them. So I wrote this fairy tale, it's a few pages long. It was about two sisters who found a dragon. Mm-hmm. And they took it home. And, that was the story, and they liked it. And then I started thinking, I could do something with this. So as they got older, the story got bigger and bigger and bigger. And eventually it wound up to be this, like, 600-page thing that I published back in 2012 called Dragon Tamer's Daughters. And it just grew from there, and
right.
that's when I started getting really serious about writing, and then since then it's just been one book idea after another.
How long does it take you to write a book like that?
Forever. Okay. Oh. So
what's the process then?
Dragon Tamer's Daughters took me like 9 years to do because I really didn't. I was still learning
right.
what to do
right.
and how to write a novel this big and edit it into something that people would actually want to read. Lost Dogs I wrote in about 2 years, so I'm getting better. It's just, finding time to write. I do an outline first, which is what I learned from the first book. So plot out where you're going first, and then write the thing. And then, so I outline it, and then I try to find time whenever I can to write it and get it done.
Peggy likes to write on her deck. Where do you like to write?
I like to write on the bus or at lunch.
Really?
I have a long bus ride from D.C., so I'll sit there with a pad.
So your legal pad, or do you use computer then?
Yeah. For this latest book I'm doing, I'm writing most of it on a legal pad, but most of them I do on a laptop.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
How soon can we see this newest one coming
up? I'm about a third of the way through it. This new one, the working title is called In Lonely Lands. I'm probably going to change that. It's a modern-day fantasy horror story about some local kids who get dragged off to a shadowy nightmare realm filled with monsters and all sorts of other nasty things.
Oh, another feel-good book.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. All right, well, you're out there. You're doing it. You're doing it. Sometimes you'll start writing a book, I imagine, and the daughters will read it, and they'll go, Dad, I don't like this. Do they read in partial, or do they have to wait till the finishing project?
It depends. It depends. I'll go along. Sometimes I'll give them stuff as they go along, but then they'll tell me, like, no, I want to see how it all turns out,
Because
okay.
Okay,
what happens next? I'm like, I haven't written anything else yet. It'll probably be another month before I get another chapter, so, they're
yeah.
too impatient for that.
Okay, so they walk away from the project halfway
right,
through
so
it.
Right, so now it's just like, here, I'll give it to you when it's done.
So you've done a lot with it. Did you go to college?
Yeah, I went to University of Maryland, College
okay.
Park, and
right.
then... While I was living in Prince George's County,
yeah.
by D.C.,
right.
I was coming up to Washington College twice a week for my master's degree,
oh,
which is insane.
Nice commute.
Yeah, yeah, it's like an hour and a half each way.
Yeah.
So,
So what is your master's in?
English Lit.
Oh, okay.
English Lit, yeah.
All right.
So
you're working on a project now. We should
right.
see that fairly soon. Ladies and gentlemen, Denton Kilgore.
Right.
Kenton Kilgore.
Excuse me.
Thank you very much. Well, Mr. Guthrie, I think it's time. Let's have some more, huh?
Sure.
That was quite interesting. Especially like the part about the dumb dog. I can identify with you. So we lost a really, really great musician today. Had a profound effect on my music, so I'm gonna play one of his songs.
Mm. Very good. Nice. In front of Queen Anne's County Television, for those you're a part of a live studio audience. So you may be able to watch this on old Channel 7 when it replays instead of, well, anyway, we won't get into that. All right, so I'd like to mention a few other in attendance here this evening. Brent Lewis, of course, Bloody Point. Brent in the back there. And a man I met who's from the northern East Coast, I believe, Harold O. Wilson, just sent out a new book called Taste of Salt, which is also available out front. And please, let's support our authors. See the merchandise tables out there. Purchase a book before you go. And if you don't want to do it here, buy something on iTunes or perhaps Amazon and take advantage of some of these local authors. We can't do it without it. Local is the key to it all. All right, we can't make these things happen. Finally, I'd like to introduce Guthrie Matthews. Guthrie, come on over here. Born in New England. Guthrie Matthews was introduced to music.
I'm not a Patriots fan.
Well, that's You got the audience going your way now. It says, of music at young age, his biggest musical influence was his father, Bill Matthews. Talented singer, songwriter, and guitarist, after moving to Maryland as a teen, Guthrie quickly made his mark on the local music scene, deciding to become a full-time professional musician at 19. Known for blurring the lines between musical styles and which Guthrie's uncanny ability to play almost any genre, that would be genre, with absolute authenticity that made him an in-demand sideman for an impressive array of artists. Sharing the stage with artists ranging from rock artist Jimmy Davies to the jazz drumming legend Chuck Reed. Guthrie drew from his experiences, and when starting his own project, Guthrie Matthews Method, with bassist Jesse Mason and drummer Chris Doerr. Ladies and gentlemen, I introduce to you formally Guthrie Matthews. Well, I got a couple of questions to ask you. You can count on that.
Sure.
So, when did you start playing music?
That's a complicated question because my dad played.
Uh-huh.
So I grew up around music. And I remember being a kid and I kind of came online to Little Feet.
Yeah.
That's the first real rock and roll music I remember hearing as a child. And I remember being in the back of Volvo station wagons back in the 80s. They were real ugly. But I'd sit in the way back, because you could do that in the 80s without a seatbelt.
No seatbelts,
yeah.
Right? Yeah.
In the snow and the ice.
Wonder how we all lived, aren't
you? In New England, yeah. So I'm back there listening to Rock and Roll Doctor and banging on the on the back seat like they were drums. So I originally wanted to play drums,
right.
But I was a kid. My interests were all over the place. But I grew up around music, so I didn't really go, that's what I want to do, till I was like 13. But I had already put my hands on the guitar and knew a few chords and all that stuff.
Did your father sit down with you and teach you guitar at night, or did you just watch him and mess around or noodle around on it, so to speak?
I would watch him. It was kind of just always around. And the first time I picked up a guitar, he had me take lessons at a school I was going to. Because his friend was teaching there, and I sat down to do the lesson, and I held the guitar like this, and the first thing, and that's how I'd always played it up at home, was upside down and backwards. And the guy picked it up, turned it around, and said, "No, like that." So that's
that's it.
That's what I learned. That was my first guitar lesson.
All right.
I learned that.
So you learned how to hold it.
Right, but later on I discovered I probably would have been better off if I had kept playing it upside down, because my right hand moves a lot faster than my left hand.
Whatever. So you're a full-time musician now, is that right?
I do. I play music part-time.
Oh, okay.
The time I'm an HVAC technician for Velocity HVAC.
Okay. All right. And you live here locally, or whereabouts?
I live in Queenstown.
Oh, okay. Queenstown. All right. And you play mostly bars then, right? Or restaurants, bars, that kind of thing?
Restaurants, everything from like, you know, bars to country clubs to weddings, corporate events, things like that. Just kind of bounce around.
Do you always play solo, or do you have a band you also play with?
I play a lot more solo gigs now than I used to, because I started playing with a few different bands. I play with the Justin Ryan band. I just play guitar in that band and sing backup vocals. And I play with Fire on the Bay with my friend Contavious Jones. And that is basically my band, which is the Guthrie Matthews Method with Contavious Jones as an added piece.
All right.
So,
how often does the whole band play together versus solo?
It's more solo gigs now than anything else, because I discovered that it was a lot easier to pay one guy than it is to pay three guys.
Tell you what, not so dumb here, huh? Very good.
Yeah.
And do you give lessons too to supplement your income?
Sometimes, if I do teach. It has to be the right situation with the right student.
Okay.
If they're aggressively wanting to play the instrument and I'll teach them.
Mm-hmm.
I know that sounds weird, but it's a lot easier to teach someone music when they have a passion for it.
Well, I don't think it sounds weird at all. I agree with you on that.
So
I'm able to afford to be picky with my students.
Do you have any current students?
I don't have any right now. My last student was Eli Enzer, who's a...
I've heard that name.
Yeah, he's a local...
Yeah.
Well, he used to live in Centerville, but he's down in Georgia now.
Oh, is he?
Atlanta, and he's pursuing his dream as a...
Oh, fantastic.
...performer, and he's got a beautiful voice, and he's come a long way on playing guitar. He's really... really stepped up.
Well, you played some of your own songs here with us this evening.
Yeah.
Have you put together a CD, or have you tried to put together a CD or album? Well, I'm not sure what they call it anymore.
That's an interesting thing, because I recorded an album in 2000, which was basically somebody said, I like what you do, can you do a blues album? And I said, sure. So I did the closest thing to that I could do. And still remain creatively. I can't do one style of music. I'd just be bored to tears if I had to do that. So I did that in 2000. It was called Sleepless Nights, and I think you can still find it around somewhere. There might actually be copies of it sitting on Amazon somewhere.
Right.
I have it.
You have it.
Now, who would that be?
I did that, and then it took me a really long time to get back in the studio. Kids, jobs, things sort of, you know, life happened.
Right.
And I was more of a working musician than anything else.
Right.
And, I wound up recording in, I think it was 2010. Might have been 2010. I recorded an instrumental album with a band called Big Bang Method.
Okay.
And that was... all, we called it neo soul metal, is what we were calling it. But it was just like basically progressive music that most people would listen to and be like, I don't understand this. and an excuse for me to make weird noises with my guitar. So
you play guitar. Do you play another instrument? Piano, anything else?
I play like piano very remedially.
Right.
And I play bass. Actually, bass was my first instrument.
Okay. So when you're writing a song, do you write with a guitar, do you write with bass, or you chime it out on a piano? Or I have one other question. I know I'm throwing a lot at you, but now it's...
Sure.
All right. Do you write the words, then the song, or the music, or do you write the music and then fit words to it? Now, that's
usually
a lot to go after there. I know.
Usually, like, if I'm actively trying to write a song, if I go, okay, I'm going to sit down and write a song.
Right.
Nothing happens.
Okay.
It strikes like lightning, and I just got to go, all right, it just happens. So I just sit down, and I write it out, and I wrote a lot of poetry in school, so a lot of that just sort of...
That feeds it.
Yeah, it helps to make it easier, you know? Mm-hmm. If you practice the rudimentary stuff, like the harder stuff is easier to do. So
right.
So coming up with rhymes and things like that.
Okay. So the more you do it, the better you are, right?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, so your love of music began at a very young age. Your father played. Mm-hmm. Is your father still around?
Yeah, we actually play it together.
Oh, do you really?
Once in a while, yeah.
Does he look at you and go, son, come on, you're getting slow there and you need to move it up an octave. Does he get on you like that, or you guys just enjoy your play?
No, usually when I play with him, I think the last time we played, we started standing up, and then he stopped in the middle of the set, and he was like, hey, can I get a chair from somebody? he sat down, and, you know, like, that's how he plays now all the time. It's just sitting down.
Okay.
It's a lot of fun playing with him. I really enjoy it.
Good deal. Well, that's wonderful. You're still able to enjoy your company with your father, and then both doing something that you love. Hey, what are some of the future events coming up that we might be able to go see you at? Off the cuff, nothing, you know, right on, but...
Tomorrow night, I'm playing at the Green Turtle in Pasadena.
Okay.
And I don't start till 10 because the Caps are playing.
All right, well, tough to compete against the Caps right now.
You know, you can't show up and when that's going on, you're like, will you listen to my song? Nobody wants to hear it. No.
Okay.
And then Saturday, I'm doing a private event. It's a fundraiser for... Habitat for Humanity.
Oh, okay.
In Talbot County.
All right.
It's a ladies' night thing at Talbot County Country Club.
Okay.
So that should be pretty cool.
All right. Well, I see your name a lot in the newspapers, and I hear it, you know, and see it in flyers and what have you. And so I think it's an opportunity for us all to go enjoy it in a little bit more proactive way. keep us all posted on what you're doing. I've loved your music this evening. I think everyone else has. And why don't you set up? I'd like to hear one more. Can we do that? Yeah, go ahead.
Rock and roll doctor.
Oh man, yeah. I can't. You know, actually, I know all the words to that song, but it's a weird song because he sings kind of in a register that I can sing, and then he hits this really high note, which is weird. I know I just did Prince, but it's a certain harmonic that I can't quite get.
Well, we thank you for your request.
Good to hear the reference to feet.
Yeah. All right. Well, while he's setting up, let's discuss a couple of other things that are coming in the near future. First of all, you know you can buy produce out here, right? Right? Farmers market is open now. We also have local businesses that we all participate and support. We also have what's coming in 2 weeks, not this weekend, but the following week, on the 29th and 30th, we have, of course, the Storytelling Festival. And that will run Friday and Saturday night. Now, today we've heard from our authors, and when you read their books, you formulate an idea. You formulate a thought in your mind, and you perceive the story as to what your mind tells you. Storytelling takes on a different attitude. Let's call it radio for the mind, if you will. Somebody is using the inflections of their voice or passion at a certain spot and putting it in there. And you're listening to these people read. So now it's another way to enjoy something that is written. So this first annual Chesapeake Storytelling Festival is a friendly, say that five times, family-friendly event, all right? And they have an opening reception on Friday. Saturday, there are five national storytellers. Saturday, there are five national storytellers. The Good Old Days, Southern singing songwriter, Mike Harrell Reno, and the Robin Williams of storytelling, Ed Stivender. A family folk tour and fairy tales section includes Harriet Tubman, living history actress Gwendolyn Briley Strand, and folklorist Ed Akonowitz. Legacy of the Chesapeake track includes bass songs and stories with Tom McHugh, Black Captains of the Chesapeake, documentary film and discussion, and local watermen story swapped, emceed by our own Brent Lewis. And that runs from 1:40 to 2:40. We have an outdoor concert Saturday evening at the event. It's 7 to 8, and there'll be ghost stories featuring Kim Whitecamp and Mindy Burgoyne. And they'll be from 8:15 to 9:30. Tickets are available online, and it's at ChesapeakeStorytelling.com. So it's another opportunity to experience some local authors. And it's a nice event. It's a beautiful college there. The grounds are beautiful, and you'll enjoy the event. So you may want to partake in that. Ladies and gentlemen, it's given me a great pleasure to stand here in front of you this evening. And I just would like to thank a few more people. First of all, I'd like to thank our guests, Kenton Kilgore, Guthrie Matthews, and Peggy Jaegly for coming here this evening. Let's give them a round of applause. We also have Jeff Strait, who's with us tonight. He handled a lot of our promotional items and our signage. Thank you very much, Jeff. We have Ted McNeil working on the cameras as well. So thank you very much. As you know, we are on being recorded, and I've said it a number of times, but some people join a production halfway in the middle. What am I watching? That's what they'll say. So here, this is the third Thursday at the Creamery, all right? And we're planning on having another event. And I'm going to let you know now, it is already scheduled for May 19th, and we will have Duan Wright as our musician, and she will be accompanied, I believe, by her bassist. Is that correct?
Guitarist,
thank you. And we'll be enjoying them. Plus, we're lining up some other authors, of course, so it should be a fun evening. I thank you for all coming. And don't forget to pass through the gift shop on your way out. All right? Raise the bar, undo your seatbelt, leave to your right, passing through the gift shop. It's just like Disneyland. And pick out something nice for the family. Okay? Something for the missus, perhaps. Anyway, thank you very much. Let's hear one more for Guthrie, and thank you all for coming. Good night.
You just mentioned Tom McHugh. He's actually a pretty mean harmonica player.
Oh, well.
And plays with my dad quite a bit.
Very good. All right.
So we were talking about my musical upbringing.
No,
I'd like to play a song by my dad.
Oh, very nice.
This is a song that he used to sing to me when I was a boy. I sing it to my kids now. Back in when he was coming up in the 50s, there was a lot of cowboys on TV. It was kind of like, I was explaining to my son's preschool that it was kind of like a picture like Han Solo, but instead of a blaster, he's got a six gun and he's riding a horse instead of the Millennium Falcon. Anyhow, I'll just play the song.
And don't forget to pay your checks, all right? And don't damage the room, remember. It was free, all right? Thank you very much. Good night.
Good job.